resolution tomorrow. Our contract is being, we're requesting the contract get us orders in for equipment quickly, get foundations in quickly, and then go away from the budget. We need your full out of the way prior to us setting on that option.
So, one of the things that I can imagine is, because the board went home, it's a petition for Verizon and National Grid. Verizon is responsible for removing those poles.
So we'll coordinate the actual logistics of it pretty early on, so we're not waiting at the end. None of these relocations, you may have seen other construction jobs where poles are in the road after the road's open. These are actually being moved further off roads, so it won't be all the case.
Cool, okay. Great, thank you very much. All right, next up is an update on the leach field project at the Children's High School. Come on, don't look out of position there. Stay away, that's the issue. Thank you very much for having me here this evening with you. I have several updates. Some very good news, and matter of fact, there's no bad news. So the last time I came to this room, that was a year ago. I sat down in this very same table with the administrator as well as a couple of your colleagues.
Yep, and the superintendent of school.
And the superintendent of school. And you mentioned to me a couple of things that were on the priority list for the town of Bolton. Three of those main priorities included the leach field for the Neshoba Regional High School, Chapter 70 funding, and regional transportation reimbursement. So, as you know, in my district, there are 11 communities. I serve all 11 communities equally. I provide the same attention to every single community, whether they are small or large. And the past year or so, I've made those three priorities of Bolton my priorities. The first thing I did was, there was an environmental bond bill that came before the Senate. I was able to get the leach bill into the environmental bond bill, all $300,000 into the environmental bond bill. That passed the Senate. It survived the conference committee. It was adopted through the legislature. And the governor signed that environmental bond bill earlier this year. The downside to that is that the governor signed that bill after the state put together their plan for 2019. So unfortunately, no projects from that bond bill was able to get into the 2019 plan for the state. As you know, when the state takes out a bond, it has a lifespan of 5 years. A project can be released within the first year, or it can be released in the towards the end of the latter of that 5 year timeline. One of the things that we did with my office was that we advocated through the governor's office trying to get that money released for this year as soon as possible. That didn't work, because once they finalize a plan for 2019 and they take out a certain bond amount of money for that plan, they cannot change it. So there are two options that my office is looking into. One is getting this released in the 2020 plan, and the other is to use my contacts up in the State House with my colleagues, try to get as much money as possible released in other avenues to support this project. I had a meeting 2 weeks ago with very high officials up in the State House. We are working to look at other programs where we can secure the funding for this project, as well as getting the governor to put this project into a supplemental budget, which is due out in about a month or two. So those are our options. And, believe me, I am working very hard to get this money to you folks Now, worst comes to worst, 2025. But I can guarantee you that if I can't get a penny release for this project this year, no one can. So we are working very hard. Now, to the very, very, very good news, Chapter 70 funding and regional transportation reimbursement. I promised to the town of Bolton, and I promised to all my colleagues that I would make education a priority for me, which I did. Worked very hard to send with my colleagues. What we did this year in terms of Chapter 70 funding was unprecedented. We increased the funding to the highest level year over year. We added $286 million to what was already funded to the highest level by the governor. And that translates to this. In 2018, Neshoba Regional High School received $96,000 in increase in Chapter 70. 2019, the school received an increase of $139,000. This upcoming school year, Neshoba Regional High School will be receiving $282,475.
That's great.
That's a huge increase.
That's great.
Now, we also in the Senate did something also unprecedented. We increased regional transportation reimbursement to the highest that we could. I met with MARS, which is the Massachusetts Regional Transportation Group. They were advocating for 85. I was trying to push very hard for 85% reimbursement, but we were able to bring it up as high as a little bit over 82%, which is higher than what the House proposed and much higher than what the governor proposed. That translates to this for regional school transportation for the Neshoba Regional High School. In 2018, they received a negative $34,766, which is a decrease for them. 2019, they received an increase of $154. This upcoming school year, the Neshoba Regional High School will be receiving an increase of $359,256. That's a great increase for regional transportation. So those are the three items that you wanted me to work on. Those are the three items I tried very hard to deliver for the town of Bolton. And hopefully in a month or two, I will bring back good news for the Leech Field. That is my last avenue in terms of declaring this project for the 2020 plan, is to get this into the supplemental budget.
Senator, I'd like to make sure that, first of all, thank you. Senator, I want to make sure that your office for the FY20 effort gets whatever they need out of me. Is there one contact person on your staff that I can work with on this?
Absolutely. I will have her, which is my chief of staff, Kristen Mylon.
Okay.
Contact you and give you her direct telephone number.
Is she related to the former rep?
Yes, she is.
Okay, I assume this much. Okay.
And my communication director here, Ariana Ura-Alushan, is also
okay.
She would also be a resource for you as well.
Okay, great. Yeah. I'll make sure she does whatever she needs.
Mm-hmm. I can tell you one thing, all the communities that I serve are in very, very good hands at the State House. We have a very good friend in the corner office, and I look forward to working with you, town administrator, to get other things that you need for the town. I believe one of the other priorities include 117.
Yes.
And lucky for you, I am a ranking member on the Transportation Committee.
Good.
And I will be working very closely with our Secretary of Transportation, Ms. Pollack. So that is something that you need to let me know what the plan is for the town.
Sure, I can take you one up there. We have done some work, as you just heard. You know, we did get a MassWorks grant, almost $1 million, to fix the intersection of Water Quad. But we've got a long-range plan for the corridor for 117. When we talk about the corridor, it's really from effectively here down to the lights at Still River Road, which is 111. My hand, sorry, it's off my line.
The Mass Works is an incredible beneficiary program.
It is.
Secretary Camille is a very good friend of mine who runs that program that runs under his jurisdiction. You should have received an email or a correspondence from my office last month, because I asked them to reach out to all the towns and cities, letting them know that the deadline for Mass Works was August 17th to get all the applications in there, and then my office and I will push those applications forward.
Okay, great, great, that's wonderful. Now we're working this Mass Works project now, so we won't be pursuing the next filing, but we are going to be refiling for under our Complete Streets, under the Complete Streets initiative. So
it's a great program.
So we'll be looking to work with your office on that.
Absolutely.
Great.
That was all
great news.
And I spoke to Bob at the senior barbecue. He wanted to know what the process is used at the State House in terms of determining what the local aid is.
Yeah.
My office will get back to you. Maybe we'll send a correspondence to you and
sure.
Share it to the board.
Absolutely.
Appreciate it very much.
Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Senator.
Thank you.
Nice to see you again.
Pleasure.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
Good to see you, Senator.
All right, next up on our agenda is approval of events. First is to review the request to hold the 2019 Rise for PKLS on September 22nd, 2019.
Do we have what we need from them, Jenny? I believe they've already met with the chief.
Yep, we do have insurance.
Yeah, we do have insurance from them.
Yeah.
Unless you might have specific questions or concerns, you could probably approve this without them being.
No, I'm assuming we've done this before, yes?
We have.
Okay.
I'm going to say yes. I'm
going to
be there at 7:30.
Oh.
Yes, we're
at 7:30. Yeah, they were on at 7:30. We're running early, but. I know you're on our time crunch, so.
Yeah. We can move forward.
Oh, sure.
Yes. Well, we'll just pause and tell the show's up at 7:30. That's great. Next up is. I'll review the request to hold the Bolton Firefighters Annual Association's second annual 5K race on November 3rd, 2019, at Forest Square. Also,
would you like me to jump ahead to the town administrator?
Why don't you do that, Don?
All right, so the town administrator's report. Well, I'm saying we could just jump to that and then come back.
Okay.
So, because otherwise, you could have a little more time on some of the other issues.
Sure.
Anyway, I have pictures tonight if any of you would like to see. We had a building committee meeting Monday.
This is meeting.
And I would like you to, if you have a chance, to look at the pictures from the project, but there was one that actually I found particularly exciting, and I don't throw that word around very often, but this is a picture of what's going on, and it's almost done, the theater.
Okay,
it's amazing. The work is on time, remains slightly under budget. The administration is already in the building. We have a temporary occupancy permit for the administration. Next week, we will have a temporary occupancy permit for the students. Student orientation is September 3rd and 4th. Teacher student orientation is the 3rd and the 4th. Opening day is the 5th. And the ribbon cutting ceremony is on October 4th at, I believe, 10 a.m. So it would be great if any or all of you could attend the ribbon cutting ceremony so you could see that firsthand. But you'll get something more formal, but I just wanted you to be aware of that. And it's October 4th. It's really thrilling to see how this project is going.
Students.
Oh, yeah, September 3rd and 4th of orientation, September 5th.
Tours and stuff at some point?
There should be tours as part of the ribbon cutting. That's my expectation, I'm sure. Yeah, oh yeah, we'd be right in the lunchtime. And they have a great cafeteria there. But it's not a cafeteria anymore, now it's a student union. But just on the other. Update on the portico. See if I remember everything Jim told me. We've gotten all the replacement put in that we needed to get, the African mahogany with the 2-week lead time. So we've got all the wood in.
Where's the mahogany?
That's the fascia of the sockets and the.
You built it in mahogany?
Yeah, we're replacing the original material.
Wow.
We like materials.
Preservation.
That is supposed to be done tomorrow. The roof is supposed to be done by the end of August, which will then complete their work for all intents and purposes. And then what's left is the power washing and whatever other tidying up we need to do of the front of the building. And then with the remaining funds, we plan to do some regrading out there and hopefully then do some plantings afterwards to spruce up the front. But the actual structural work is still, we're being told, is going to be done by the end of the month.
Okay,
cool.
Well, I look forward to that.
Me too.
Should be a ribbon cutting? Tonight should be a scaffolding.
My staff is going to be thrilled. We'll probably have our own ribbon cutting ceremony in the form of pizza cutting once that's done. So everybody can park up front again and we don't have the noise anymore. But it's going to look very, very nice. And we're also looking at, as was suggested, take a look at potentially relocating the flagpole so it can be more easily viewed because it can be obscured out there. So is there a better location for it? We're going to take a look at that. And that's certainly appropriate work to do within the $13,000 plus or minus we'll have remaining. So we're hoping to turn a little more money back to the town. And then, nobody here for the rides yet. I'll just give you, we don't have a final answer yet, but I said that I would update you on one of my goals for FY20. Joe and I had a preliminary discussion about ours at the transfer station. And again, nothing's hard and fast yet. We looked at possibly cutting hours on Wednesdays, and we felt that probably wasn't a good idea. We could potentially save $2,500, but the concern was people that work, you know, well out of town, say Boston, if we cut 7 o'clock to 6 o'clock, that may not give people time that rush and come out of town, and then it's when they're going to be going away for the weekend to be able to get something up there. What we are going to take a look at though is potentially cutting the hour, closing time on Saturday from 3 o'clock to 2 o'clock, and potential benefits there would give us another hour to work. On DPW projects, and I think with proper notice, you know, when we have people showing up, you know, of course, just before 3 o'clock, with proper notice, then they can adjust to 2 o'clock.
It would be a transition.
It would be a transition, exactly. But that's what we're going to look at right now for that. And we don't have a final proposal, as I said, but that's what we're talking about.
Yeah, I'm just curious, you were talking about possibly changing the closing hours on Wednesday. Not the closing hours, not the opening hours on Wednesday?
Not the opening hours, no. We were looking more at the closing hours.
I was monitoring that and verified even yesterday, which was pretty much an off week before people go back to school. And the first hour yesterday when we opened, we had 40 cars.
Yeah,
it's amazing. The
we're much easier earlier than we are later.
Okay, so no, that's a good thing. It's good to
do. So, unless the board has any questions for me, that's all I have under the town administrator's report.
Okay.
Great.
We have someone who just arrived. If you happen to be Mike
Burton. I am, yes.
Well, then come on down.
Can I come up here?
Sure, please do.
How are you?
It's a good day.
Thank you.
So you are requesting to hold the 2019 rides in the future. That's on September 22nd.
Yeah, this is your 19th year.
Okay. And I would assume you've got all your insurance and you've got your chief, and it's very similar to the previous year.
So you've got proof, yeah.
All the good answers. Does the gentleman have any questions?
Mm-hmm.
All
Alright, and seeing none, I'll take a motion to approve the request.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Great, there you go. We have to be supportive, there'll be a lot of people that'll benefit from this.
That's great.
Good, just be supportive.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Alright, all set.
Yes, all set.
Can I do that?
Absolutely.
Alright, thank you again.
So the next, I see Eric is here, just wanted to zoom up to the next agenda item. We have a discussion regarding the Joseph Farm Road 14 housing project.
Who am I getting right here?
How are you?
I am good, how are you? So as you are aware, we received notice that an application was submitted to Mass Housing for a 40B development at the corner of Berlin Road and Farm Road. So as part of that process, the Board of Selectmen had an opportunity to provide comment to Mass Housing as one of the initial steps. So that is why I'm here this evening. I have a plan here. See it? I highlighted it just to sort of help guide you along. So this is, I'm highlighting the property line here. It's about a 2.5 acre site. About 26 acres of wetland bordering vegetation wetlands on the property. There's a Berlin Road here, on the Farm Road there. This is actually the old Coolidge property. Bob Coolidge actually still owns the property over here, and I believe he leases it to a tree and landscaping company. Fulton Conservation Trust owns open space property here, as well as across the street. And there are some direct abutters along Berlin Road and below further down the road. So the developer for the project is proposing four single-family units. I should know where I have that. So it's what we're calling a cottage-style house. It's about 1,700 square feet. There'll be two bedrooms, 2.5 baths. The planning board did weigh in last week with some preliminary comments as well, and one of their comments was asking the developer to go through the design review board process because we have to shut down the other members have great feedback when it comes to the architectural design of the home. So hopefully they'll come out to that. I think this is relatively nice style and some tweaks I think it could fit in here.
Yeah.
That's that. They're proposing two curb cuts off of the public roads, one off of Berlin and one off of Farm Road. When we did our site visit with Mass Housing last week, along with several of the town officials, both DPW and police weighed in that they would like to see this entrance moved a little further down Berlin Road to get away from this intersection here. This is actually the revised plan and audit today from becoming the assistant engineer, and they have moved it slightly. The problem is there is the border vegetation here, so you know, wanting to approach within the 25-foot no disturb area, so we're trying to protect that as well. There's going to be a shared well, a shared septic system, and I think that's covered.
So is one affordable?
One will be affordable, so three will be market, one will be affordable. According to what they submitted to Mass Housing, they anticipate selling the market rate units at $500,000, which is relatively affordable for Bolton, and then the affordable unit will go for about $185,000.
So it's 1,700 square?
1,700 square.
And then that unit is affordable in perpetuity?
In perpetuity. Exactly, right, so it will be de-restricted, so, and that will be governed by DHCD or whatever that.
But unless they can't find a buyer?
No, not anymore.
Really?
Yeah, so if you can't find a buyer, I'll check.
Because we had that problem before.
We have, and I think we've resolved that issue.
Oh, good, that's great.
Yeah, but I think we've resolved it, so I'll double check on that. But these now survive, they're able to do it.
So will they be basically four identical? I mean, but let's assume that this is the group before like this, okay?
Yeah, I think they're varying colors, but this is the style of the home.
Okay.
So.
Cool.
Yeah, there's no floodplain, no endangered species, no vernal pools to deal with. This is the area that's the property there.
Yeah, I know.
So that, yeah, the comment I would add is that it's a very urban condition that's creating and having very little room for kind of a buffer between the road and the driveway. And I know that the site is tight because of the wetlands, but you know, houses in the back roads typically don't have their driveways like right up against the road. So it's kind of like a main street.
I completely agree.
They're doing sort of they can increase the vegetated buffer between the driveway and the road.
Yeah, that's actually something that I had here for a comment for you guys. Potentially, I just mentioned that's how they want, you know, they really need to provide some landscaping buffer.
Basically, this is not that.
And there's actually an existing tree that I talked to the developer when we went out to say, because I'd really like to see them saved. Rebecca, do you remember what was that?
Landscaping can increase those pressures, especially on this side. It sounds pretty tight.
One thing that the planning board when they moved in, they had asked if we could just get rid of this entrance altogether and just have the one entrance on the farm.
I'm confused about why they are looking to reduce increased vegetation.
And then the only thing, like, conservation had asked that they stake the property line here, just so there's no confusion as to where the conservation land is part of any
construction.
That's the 100-foot buffer, so I apologize, I didn't mention that. So they will be having to submit to the Conservation Commission for a notice of intent. They do have one dwelling unit and part of another dwelling unit with another foot buffer along with creating and part of the subject.
So normally that's not allowed, but
No, that is a lot. So they would, if this was a, let's say they only had this one single home and they were in the buffer, they'd still have to, they potentially could do it, they just don't have to do the compound. So as far as waivers from our local bylaws and regs, I think it'll be limited. For zoning, it's really just a matter of, you know, increasing the number of units on a single lot. I don't think any other zoning waivers are being requested.
So where is their backup septic system?
So it's the way that they do it is it's in between the leaching beds.
Okay.
And then they're raising this up 5 feet.
Now, I'm assuming because they are in line, so this house can't move. Right?
So
if you want to add more of the buffer, you could possibly move this one back or angle it a little bit to get a little bit more there. And if you do the, you're proposing to do the one entrance there as opposed to just getting rid of this one?
Well, that's what the planning board had recommended, but I haven't brought that to their attention.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, the only way you can get more vegetation is you pull this one back and so you have some more of an angle.
They can go inside the 100-foot.
They can.
Can they put a septic system inside the 100-foot?
So this leach field is going to be 5 feet higher than the driveway?
Yeah, so this is at 362.
Mm-hmm.
No, I'm sorry. And then, the house will be higher.
Okay.
So the basement level is 367 and this is 362. So I'll put together a comment letter then for you, and then hopefully you can get it signed in the next week or two, and get it off to my son.
Does it need to be signed by the chair or all three selectmen, what's your call?
No, it doesn't matter, it's like, you know, if it makes it easy.
Do we have to vote on the letter, or?
I don't believe you do, no. The chair's authorized, so we just discuss the chair's authorized to sign the letter.
So if you don't mind, I'll just combine all the comments.
Sorry.
You did, she's upstairs. She is in the house, they are, you can do a special contract now, so.
There's some good equipment in there.
Thank you, Mayor.
Are we expecting that or something from the fire department here?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, if you want to tag it, let's keep going.
So I believe Jenny or Don had scored you the brief summary, it wasn't very brief, I do apologize. And then the maps as well regarding the fourth grade of our property.
We have color for you.
I have color for you.
Yeah.
So we have the one that's just signifying where it is in the town. And this is relation to the, our other open space parcels.
It's a very smooth notes by the packet tonight, and everything is very dark. The maps are just fine.
Okay. We had one included that showed the parcel itself from the fire Sunday.
This is off of Fort Bush. This is for sale.
Yes, correct. Adjacent to a single family home property, which is highlighted in red on that, or it's the smaller.
That's the one, like sand pit area?
Yep. And then on the opposite side of this parcel's frontage is conservation land, which about state property, and then on the opposite side of that, more conservation land. So we are basically, on behalf of the commission, requesting and hopefully receiving support, but also authorization to do further research into funding opportunities. Sunbridge Valley trustees have received contact from a few interested residents from the Wilder Road common driveways that back up to this property, who have emailed myself as well in terms of just showing interest, what can we do, how can we help. So we would also potentially be reaching out to Sunbury Valley trustees along with our own land trust to see what other funding opportunities there are aside from grants that we're aware of. Another important thing to note about this property is it is currently under chapter, which means the town does have the first refusal. And their forestry management plan runs out in about 2 more years, I believe, which at that time they wouldn't have any, or they wouldn't have as many repercussions for taking it out of that use.
From the description you've provided, it's a very mixed habitat. It's unique and open in that way. It already puts conservation land. I see you've got an old railroad bed that's marked on, you know, part of the Central Massachusetts line. So I think it's a desirable piece of property to preserve.
And tonight, what Rebecca's asking for is just approval from the board to go out and seek what opportunities there might be to occur.
Sure. Absolutely. Can we need a vote on that, please? I'll take a motion to vote to
preserving the property.
Yep.
So moved. Second.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
has there been any interest by any commercial developers yet?
It is residential. There was a plan, an engineered plan drawn up, I believe it was before planning board, a year ago, and it's since fizzled out. I don't know who brought that forward, if it was the property owner or someone who was looking to purchase that property. So it is under, I guess, threat of development. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for my chance for that. Thank you for being here. Did you just confirm that you're coming? When I asked for insurance, he said maybe we should postpone. Maybe see that now.
Okay.
All right. So we're going to postpone that because we weren't expecting the insurance certificate. We don't have it. Let me just get Kristen.
Okay.
Thank you very much for coming. Are you giddy as hell over there?
Not giddy, I am ecstatic. Yeah. I sold a few days before another issue and he beat me some more. You guys do better.
He actually courted me at school and he was just beaming.
Yeah.
And so happy.
Well, you know, that's the wonderful thing, right? Just falling and as time gets just right. So it's good.
So, and this is what we did now.
Right. Sure. So you sold on August 15th and you had 8 bids, which is a lot. It's a fairly small size, 2.8 million, which is relatively small. Part of it was a refunding of the 2009 issue. So what that means was Rachel will now be going back to the existing bonds, which is almost like you're about to refinance the mortgage. So we did that, and we're ending up over the life, the remaining life of the bond saving about $250,000. Our net present value savings of just under 12%, which is fantastic. We'd like to see before we present any sort of refunding opportunities at least 3% net present value savings. So we want to do that. You did really well. The winning bidder was Fidelity Capital Markets out of Boston. Your TIC, which is your true interest cost, which takes into account the coupon rates and the yields on the bonds, for the 1.08. So it's you do really well.
So just as a reminder, when we went out for the first bond sale or refinancing, we saved about $330,000. So between these two resales, we've saved $580,000 over the life of the debt.
Nice.
And Krista did not go along, but Krista deserves much of the credit.
This time around, with this particular refinancing, there was a lot of paperwork and documentation. There was a lot more to this, and I have to say, every single department here absolutely jumped in with the first, you know, went over and above getting me what I needed to get it was kind of a big effort. And I just wanted to kind of just remind everyone as well, the reason I think we did so well on the market is we were able to maintain our AAA bond rating. Nanoshka and I actually, with our advisor David Eisenfeld, we had a conference call a few weeks prior with S&P, and we were able to just kind of give them a little bit of an update about, we haven't closed 19 officially, but just, you know, where we were heading and where we thought we were going to end up. So we were able to make that.
Yeah, so we maintained the AAA with a strong forward outlook.
That's great. Yeah. Since we just lost over, and I think you know, it needs to be said again. I mean, I think despite what, you know, some people are not necessarily happy with the taxes and whatnot, but we have, the town has done a tremendous job over the years to be fiscally conservative, and we've done an excellent job compared to many towns. And Standard & Poor's, which reviews us on a regular basis, we have the highest rating that Standard & Poor's can give to a town like us, and that's AAA. And that's a large measure in part why we can get such a fabulous interest rate and save the kind of money that we're saving. So, again, thank you very much.
Mark, are there any highlights you'd like to talk about as far as the factors that had S&P maintain the bond rating?
Honestly, I did not read the report, and I apologize. I didn't know you were asked the question, but I'm assuming it's just so when you guys sold at the beginning of the year, that's when you got the AAA, and you're maintaining that. So, you obviously haven't closed out 19 yet. Those factors, so from what you're projecting it to be, there's no concerns. And if there was, they won't necessarily downgrade right away, but put what they do have outlooks of positive, stable, or negative, and nothing changed. So they're moving right along as far as they're concerned.
And I think the big part of that was fiscal financial policies that we had to continue to run at. One of the biggest factors, and we came right up and said this, was we continue to fund our OPEB funds. We do continue to run that.
It's one of the things that not everybody can say, and we do take that into account when they evaluate the other side. So.
We often complain about how little state aid we get to our direct budget. In the report for Standing Forest, they commented about the lack of reliance on state funds is a plus for this town. And so, I was surprised that they took note of that, but I was pleased it ended up at this time. I'm glad something finally came out. No,
well, they look at, so you have to look at it. So how they're viewing it is, that's one of the things that you have really no control over. And the more you depend on it,
right,
the bigger hit it is when it gets reduced or it doesn't get increased the way that you projected it to be. So from a revenue side, you're not as reliant on it as another community that's getting 60%.
Right. It's just remarkable. It's something we've been complaining about for years.
Exactly. The problem is
going to be a
lot
of money.
Yes, exactly.
I'll take it.
Yeah. So. Yeah.
So we're going to need a bunch of signatures.
You're going to need an actual formal vote first. Yes.
I thought that's right.
Yeah.
You
have the word document. You can either read it in full, which is 2 pages, or you can just have it in motion to say it's written, whatever it is more comfortable.
Say that the Board of Board of Selectmen, and then go through the first paragraph, and then as stated in the document, which is a public record.
Okay. All right. So this is a vote of the Board of Selectmen, stating that I, the clerk of the Board of Selectmen, that's you, the town of Bolton, Massachusetts, the town certified at a meeting at the Board held on August 22, 2019, in which all members of the board were duly notified and in which a quorum was present, following votes from unanimously passed, all of which appear upon the official record of the board in my custody. So we're voting on the refinancing of a variety of bonds for trucks and other bonds and good stuff. That's all of this document right here.
So all of the stuff that we're going to talk about.
Okay.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Do you need some form of certified benefits? I think that voter
will... No, because this vote will be signed along with all the other documents. That will go back to your bond council, and then you'll be all set. So I tried to separate each document out. There are many, many signatures. There are 9 bonds here. Each one has to sign. And then we, again, everyone needs to sign the vote of the selectmen.
So you sign
them
at the conclusion?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
It, honestly, as long as it's signed by Monday morning.
Okay, so so next up, before the selecting business, in the interest of time, I will confirm my public service announcements to the next meeting. And we also have anything to stop, so.
Nope.
Okay, so we'll go to the next one. Next up is to execute the intermunicipal agreement for regional housing services provided by Metro West CD.
I believe there is a copy of the package, and I have another copy for you to sign.
All right.
So, I move to execute the intermunicipal agreement for regional housing services provided by Metro West CD.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, next up is the recognition of Mrs. Veruca Baum as recipient of the Bolton Post Cane.
Yes, the background for this is actually very lengthy. The tradition started back in 1909 by a publisher of the Boston Post newspaper. He sent gold plated canes to all the towns in New England with the instructions that these canes be continually awarded to the oldest citizens in those towns. And Bolton continued that tradition for many years until a few years ago. And we recently agreed to start that up again. And what I'm asking from the board is recognition that Rudolph Vaughn is the eldest resident in town, and that she be awarded the Boston Post cane in recognition of that. This cane is now on display up in the second floor of Town Hall in a very nice case put together by, constructed by Bob Romer. It's accompanied by a plaque that Alice Romer put together, and Ms. Baum will certainly be ceremonially awarded the cane, but she's also going to be inscribed glass apple as her commemorative gift of the event.
That's great.
So I move that the Board of Selectmen recognize Rua Bond as recipient of the Boston Post cane.
Second. All those in favor signify saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye. Next up is the discussion regarding the existing signposts at the intersection of Main and Water.
I live in jail, Milwaukee Post. Yes. So, especially the first for that. It's one of the few locations in town where we have, you know, multiple signs directing folks to various places to visit. And you've all seen it, and it seems to be pretty nondescript, but it's if you're westbound on Main Street, just before you get to the Common, signifies all of those locations, including the hospital in Clinton. The only sign that has any bearing under the MUTCD, therefore really legitimately allowed out in a roadway, is the hospital sign. The other, though, I think are unique to Bolton, where we do want to promote businesses and direct people to them in a pretty good way. So they're in the way for the project. And what I mean in the way is when we put the grass strip in and we have the sidewalk behind it,
you must have 6 foot natively minimum clearance to the sign. You just can't achieve it with this. It's just in the way.
Right.
So alternatively, that sign is currently right in this location here.
Mm-hmm.
Alternatively, we'd like to move it over to the vicinity of where the FEMA signboard is on the common side. It's away from the sidewalk, it's behind where the parking is going to be, still visible from all travelers, and I think we'd still save the same purpose, and then the hospital sign will remain at that location at the proper height. And what we really want to do is apprise the board of the need to do that before we talk to the businesses. We would hate to talk to them first, and let you folks know it. We will deliberately go to each of these patrons and let them know our intention to do this.
So right now there's an illuminated sign on the town common.
The FEMA sign?
The
con itself. It's the kiosk.
More of the granite post. Yeah. Yes, and there's a light sign.
Yeah, no. Is but what about that connector board? The message board? Not the permanent one. There was one that was like
you're gonna grab the words, but it really is not very attractive, and it really doesn't belong there.
Okay.
So one of the things that we're hoping to do, and now that we've awarded the contract for the project itself, any residual funds that might remain toward the end of that, we're hoping to allocate towards putting a more ornamental type of message board out in that location.
Okay. As opposed to the thing that looks like it's potentially temporary.
It almost is always, with the exception of the rare occasions like with Bolton 15 Lancaster Park, it was moved from the Holton Building when I first got here. To this location, which I guess folks always thought was where it ought to be.
Certainly not the most attractive piece.
It's not the right introduction to the common.
No, but why is it there anyway? I mean, it's not being.
We put messages up there when you use for your dark license are available. Don't have to blow it. It is a message on a very, very regular basis.
I would say.
So it's been left there rather than transporting it back and forth with the DPW.
So my first question is, would that block this?
No.
And my second question is, I think if you push it farther down the west side of the road, by the time people see it, they're going to miss the turn. So I'm wondering, shouldn't it come maybe 100 feet further east?
So the problem is height, not the information that's contained on it. When you look at where the sidewalk is, the grass strip, and where the curb is to the street, the area where that sign would go, you need to maintain on your minimum height to your first sign 6 foot 8 inches from the sidewalk. That's a requirement
for the foot, for state roads, or
for all roads. All roads. To put that string of signs, this thing gets like 15 feet tall. To get that whole string of signs on it. That 5 feet of signage would have to go on top of 6 feet. It's 12 feet tall.
Yeah.
But there could be smaller signs, like you can see putting in signs as you come off the interchange for 95. Smaller signs with arrows, maybe at 6 or 8.
Aren't you going to have the same problem if you put it farther west?
If we got it, when we get further west and behind the sidewalk on the common property itself, it's not obstructed and we can get it at a height.
Yeah, they're going to get the signs.
You can't put it on the pole?
No, that's the pole we just moved. That's why
that's
fun. You just ordered to move that pole back here.
You can't put it on the new pole.
Not officially.
It wouldn't be nice.
The signs as they are now do block a visual. Like if you're going to cross there, cars can't see the pedestrians. So there's just an issue.
This conversation is exactly what we hoped we would get out of this meeting because the consultants first thought is put the hospital sign in and nothing else.
Yeah.
And I said, you can't do that in this town without folks knowing
what the alternatives might be, yeah, and to exhaust all alternatives.
All right, Brad, we can just...
Was there an issue with putting up a sign of the, this way to the public safety center? Was that supposed to be included in somewhere in the law?
I'm knocking off that.
I think there was some discussion about doing that.
There was some discussion, but
yeah,
with the hospital sign,
right?
Like the public safety. Is there a symbol for that? Public safety building.
All right, so this pole's moving back, right?
This pole will be moving back to a public position.
Okay, so this sign is right in front of this pole. Is that not correct?
That's correct.
Can't we put this sign in front of this new pole?
On private property. That would be the problem. Get it behind the sidewalk. The sidewalk in this area is right on the property line. That sign would end up on private property.
And then you still end up with the height issue. The height issue.
So the pole is on private property? The pole is how to get the angle, because you don't see what's happening. The roadway is widening, the sidewalk is coming back. It'll be in a grass strip that's further back here. So what's now paved is going to be grass strip. That's where the utility pole will go.
Okay, so why can't then that what's remaining here be right in front of that pole?
We would still not have the adequate height. To the lowest point of sign, you need to have that 6'8".
Well, maybe we can work on smaller signs that are all the same, like coming through the court.
We have ample time to address this.
Two posts, 15, 20 feet apart.
Different messages.
Yeah. Different signs.
But the other. So, what we own in the contract that we love to bid on is simply remove and reset the wonky pole.
Right.
Remove and reset it. Where it goes, we really literally have to the end of construction.
Right. Okay, so we have time.
We have time to do that.
I think we need to make a commitment to the businesses, the firms, that the site will be relocated in a place that will be effective. That
won't
negatively impact them.
Now that this is public, there's probably going to be requests for additional means too. So,
and then maybe you want to talk to EDC because they've done a little bit of wayfinding design.
Or what you get is you get a miniature version of electronic billboards and they rotate.
The quaint village of Bolton. I think you don't want that.
Or you do like they do at the airports with the revolving letters, and then you light it to the front. See?
We need to come back with some alternatives for the board. You can see
us.
There is a light there, so people are going to stop and have more time to look at this.
Without looking at the hardware on the light, there were lane assignments. We could fit, maybe room on that mast arm for the direction of the public safety building, and the hospital site could be on the mast arm.
Yeah. If
there's sufficient room.
Yeah. Okay.
Which would free up real estate on a post. Yeah. But I'm looking at
that. Okay. So, we now have to look.
Yeah. So what I'm asking is that as we continue this conversation, other than what's aware of it, we will start conversations with the business owners that are on there. And there is one business that's not in town yet. And that's Davis Farmland, who's actually a different community.
Sure. Yeah.
Well, I'm not so sure
that it's
not
in town.
Because it's from 495?
So I appreciate the discussion and knowing that there'll be plenty of time. Dawn probably asked me to start reaching out to these folks and we'll get that conversation moving forward. But before we get a final location, obviously we're going to have some folks pay to endorse it.
So just, and I probably should have done this under my report, but I didn't want to take away from Joe's. But Joe referenced earlier the bidding in the intersection. So in round numbers, I don't have them memorized, but in round numbers, the low bidder was $747,000. The high bidder was over $1.1 million. And I should say the apparent low bidder, unless they're no longer apparent, but I'm going to call them the apparent low bidder. The apparent low bidder right now is ETL from SCOE, which runs the line. I don't know that they have.
They're so big, I bet they haven't done anything in Bolton in a long, long time. I've never heard of it. But you know, this is all the business leases are breakdown. Down below is just a timetable what I'm looking to follow. We've already reviewed the tabulation of these of the low bidder. Everything's in line, everything's appropriate. They are the more than a fair low bidder.
Okay.
And what the board ought to probably do, if it doesn't already have the authority to direct Mr. Lowe to execute a contract on behalf of the town. So we want to get moving quickly on this, of course, so we get that equipment to what it's supposed to come any time on signal equipment.
So,
yeah,
we'll
vote
that I'll sign
anything
and everything I need to sign
to get that moved. And I have another graphic for those intent to award that I'm going to just let the TNL know that we intend to award.
Okay. I'll make a motion to the town administrator to award the contract for improvements to Main Street and Water Project to the low bidder.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you very much.
And just goes to show that we have over 30 requests for bid packages. And we have 5 bids.
So very, very, very tight economy. And actually, the bid spread is really not that far out. And they're all in line with the engineer's estimate.
Yeah.
Don't be alarmed by the total. Not looking close. Just as, by way of structure a bit, it's a unit cost contract. We've been here for big comparison purposes. We have items in there for manholes and catch bases that we may not need to replace, but we have items in there. So the number will move down from there.
Yeah.
Okay.
So what's the worst case then?
What happens with the slogans coming back?
Hopefully we're going to put it on a verbal message for the sign that's extended. We can do lots of improvements within the intersection under the intersection under the umbrella of the grant, so long as it meets the spirit of what the grant is going to
work. But any money that isn't spent obviously gets returned to the town. I mean,
We will never do that.
So we don't like to give money back, and actually the state is not wild about getting it back, because then they have to reprogram it. So they want us to spend all the money.
We'll spend $2 over and I'll pay for the difference.
Thank you,
thank you very much. That's great. Okay, next we have to approve bills and payroll warrants, W-2002 and W-2002A, W-2003 and W-2003A, and W-2004 and W-2004A.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, and we do not have any votes. Okay, we do not have to go into executive session.
I will move to adjourn.
I'll second that. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.